Okay, the second point which you said is that what happens to your loan book?
Yes.
Now, along with your numbers, when you came and declared, and you really, in a sense, were very honest in admitting that, look, I've got a problem. I'm making a watch list. There is a problem which I'm admitting, but this is the high watermark beyond which I would not go.
Yes.
So if I revisit your credit guidance was a slippage of 200 to 250, your slippage which you've given. There's a UBS report which says that there is going to be a significantly higher change in management guidance of slippage by 125 to 150 bps.
So I don't know where this has come from. I mean, without you know wanting to get into details of that, I think some discussion should have happened with management before you know numbers like these get put out. So to that extent, I feel disappointed. When we had our fourth quarter results, we clearly said that you know for the current year, our credit cost guidance was going to be 205 basis points.
Yeah.
Out of which 80 basis points was subsumed in quarter four by way of the contingency provisions, and that for the remainder of the year, our credit cost guidance was 125 basis points. I'm saying this again, that nothing has changed. I'm not changing the guidance by a single basis points. We stick to the fact that in this year, our credit cost will not exceed 125 basis points. So let's put that matter to rest once and for all.
But the scenario, Mr. Gill, when you communicated this guidance along with your numbers versus today, the scenario really has not improved. If you really think about the general lay of the land,
yes,
slowdown in terms of demand, in terms of whether, high frequency data points, the liquid in the system, the macro hasn't improved.
So the interesting thing to note over here is that, and I made that point at this stage itself, that the book that you put out there, which was our sub-investment grade book, and then a subset of that was the watch list, was not a very granular book. It wasn't as if that there was a general migration of a portfolio to sub-investment grade. I mean, these were just a few concentrated names which were experiencing illiquidity at that point in time. And if I look at it from that standpoint, in each of those names, we've had progress since the time that we had our year-end results in terms of either asset sales, change in shareholding, and in some cases, you know, change of control. So either that has happened in certain cases or is now on the cusp of happening. And the good thing about, you know, having just a few concentrated names is that just as they can come and, you know, cast a cloud over you in terms of magnitude, when the resolution happens, the resolution also happens very quickly. And the mood and the sentiment can change very quickly around that, given the fact that it's just a handful of names.
Okay. Now, the names are out in the public. I'll leave the option to you whether we want to discuss individual names or not, but just for the benefit of our viewers, Dewan Housing, ADA Group of Companies, SL Group of Companies, have you got any sense from your current borrowers that they are on course to really not default and repay their obligations?
So the point I made with respect to actual progress has happened either in terms of a stake sale or in terms of change in shareholding, change in ownership. It's happening to this very portfolio.
Okay.
It won't be right for me to get into specifics with regard to any of these names. But what I will say is that from the time that you provided our credit cost guidance to now, there has actually been very tangible progress in this the entire sub-investment grade book that we had talked about.
Okay. So I don't want to get this one wrong. Please feel free to correct this one. I'm choosing my words carefully. What you're telling us and what you're telling our viewers is that you're not confident, but you are certain,
yes,
that there will be no more slippage in your current guidance, irrespective of whatever happens.
I'm still saying that I'm drawing a line under the guidance that I provided, the credit cost guidance that I provided during our year-end results. Nothing has changed from that.
In financial markets, they say never. What is the risk?
Look, you asked me that, what is my current sense of conviction with regard to the guidance that we provided. And I'm saying that I'm more convinced than ever that the guidance that we provided, we'll stay within that.
In hindsight, the whole watch list, now some would argue that, look, you wanted to be frank, open and transparent. Markets have not received that well. In hindsight, do you think that was a mistake?
It wasn't a mistake. I think if you see why this is coming is that they have seen this happen in the case of two other banks.
Yeah.
Where a watch list was provided, and then that watch list continued to grow over subsequent quarters. Do remember that in those cases, what happened was a certain cyclical bind that they got into, which was the cement, steel, power thing, and which, given the fact that it was cyclical and it had to do with sectors, that unless the sector came out of the problem, I mean, your portfolios could not be remedied. For us, it's not a question of cyclicality. It's not a question of being caught in a particular sector or an industry. What we are saying is that this is just a bunch of names which have all at the same time experienced a little bit of illiquidity subsequent to the events that happened in September. And to that extent, the coming out of that doesn't have to be protracted. We are not dependent on external factors, either in terms of regulation, in terms of, you know, industry dynamics, for us to be able to come out of that. So the reason that the market has a sense or you know, took this with a pinch of salt, if I can say that, is because they have seen this happen in...
Once bitten, twice shy.
Twice shy, but the context in the two is dramatically different.
That point, that's a great explanation. You would have seen what rating agencies are indicating.
Yes.
They've not cut the guide. They've not cut their rating, but
yes,
they are indicating that it is for review.
Yes.
And the reasoning why they are communicating to us is that the rating of Yes Bank could be for review is because they think that there could be an issue with asset liability and also in terms of some of the loan repayments. So can we go back to that same point and say that they are...
So when the you know, some of the rating agencies spoke with us, one of the concerns that they expressed was about the NBFC sector. Now, the point I would like to make right now is that if I look at my you know, NBFC exposure, all of it is current as we speak right now. But there have been certain NBFCs that have got downgraded. And obviously, when you get downgraded, there's always a concern with respect to what could happen. And there is enough happening in those you know, companies for us to know exactly how they're remedying the situation, whether it's in terms of recapitalization, whether it's in terms of M&A, whether it's in terms of strategic stake sales. So we feel comfortable on that. So first and foremost was some concern that, you know, how does that sector pan out vis-a-vis us? And then the second one was, you know, the timing of the capital raise. And the reason it has been put on review is that they would like to see some resolution happen on both these fronts for them to be able to take a call. That's it. And if the concerns were more fundamental, I think it would have, you know, the consequences could have been more severe.
Hmm.